safe on our roads within the Liverpool City region?
Yeah, absolutely. And one of the things that we will do, I've discussed this with colleagues, is we will bring an item on the second before we give the structure plan to this committee. One of the things that we have agreed to do, and we've got some support from the Department of Transport to help to do this. We're going through a process at the moment of what we're calling identifying the key desire lines. So if we didn't have a cycle network, if you look at the large future generators, where would we look to put our infrastructure? So we're doing that for cycling, we're also doing this similar exercise for walking as well, across the open city region. What we'll then do is pick three or four to design that in quite level of detail. And that's where we'll come back to this committee today. So for this stretch of highway, this measure may be appropriate. For that stretch, it may be this, to get a view from yourself and where you think that's the right approach or not.
Go on.
Thanks, Chair. Take a slightly different view than I'm talking about now. I like, I absolutely insist my grandchildren on help. For myself, I wouldn't quite fancy doing that, so I'm flipping out and quite often getting onto a bike in the first place. I don't know why that is. I just think that would be so. I picked up from the report, it was saying if everything could have been perfect way, that you know, you didn't have a car in a particular area, that would eliminate what the big of it. Because the previous answer said if someone gets knocked down by a car, the helmet isn't going to be all protected for over injury to be sustained. But when the council of car raised an issue and was answered by the said we have a revenue issue about doing something. Years ago, when I rode a bike and I'd be on a cycle path, everyone avoided the cycle path because it was next to a hedge rope, glass. You were guaranteed, no one cleaned it, you were guaranteed you'd get a puncture. Having a bike puncture in the dark, cold, wind, rainy, Merseyside area isn't the best thing in the world to be doing. So, motorsport, so exactly. Where that's going to be. But I was somewhat intrigued in the report when it said that 80% of respondents wanted cyclists to have a safer scheme. What did the other 20% want to have?
Is there a response to that? Yeah.
That was the most important one knocked down as well.
Okay, Tony.
Occasionally I'm suspect of government and private enterprise schemes that invest in public infrastructure to deliver something. Now, I don't know whether you've read recently in the press, but the bike mountains that are happening in China, due to the GPS-enabled bikes, where you're operating your smartphone, and they've got bikes lying on the side of the road everywhere, and the mountains up. There's three particular companies, Mobike Ofo and formerly Blue GoGo. They were the Uber for bikes. Now, when companies invest in public infrastructure, they want something in return. They've got mountains of these bikes that will end up on our shores. Without a shadow of a doubt, they'll end up on our shores. We build the infrastructure to do that, but I think it will need some controls into how that's delivered. I mean, there is a fear that these bikes will be dumped here, and we'll have the responsibility for them for eternity.
Yeah, coming on a little bit on that,
just
as experience, I think. Slightly foolishly said that they were van-proof and death-proof, and Manchester went or seemed to have all out destroyed them. I've heard that they've got something like 20% of bikes left, currently. The good on the positive side, what these doctors' bike schemes are is they're free to the city. So there are no costs to the city because the revenue streams from the companies are from the data and from the rental charges. They normalise site cleaning that normal people, you know, the people that you can see on these bikes, they're for short journeys, which are the ideal journeys that you want to see. But the downside is that there does seem to be where the bikes are dumped, where they're stolen, on the anti-social sites. So what's needed is there needs to be a proper code of conduct, and when they do go into the city, they need to really work with the city partners in a really close way so that they understand the cities that they're going into, and they understand the local authorities, and that some of these issues don't come up. So I think they can be a positive thing, but at the moment it's almost like there's too many of them, and it's a little bit like the Wild West at times. So, but it doesn't have to be a bad thing.
Any further questions or comments? I suppose I'll just reiterate the point that has been raised a number of times about the fact that this is a late report, because everyone, you're absolutely correct, that's not good enough, and certainly while we appreciate John's apology, I don't think it's his individual culpability in that. I think as an organisation we've got to be a lot better at dealing with those things, and I know certainly Nick Noonan, as one of our new directors, is starting to focus on that quite assiduously. Certainly, kind of the suggestion about forwarding it round everyone is a very good one if the situation ever occurred again, and we hope it wouldn't. And I'll certainly bear that in mind, because obviously that's something I should have thought of as a means of being able to kind of deal with that. Otherwise, I think we've had a really good debate there, and it's certainly kind of an issue that we're all pretty sort of exercised about, and thank John for not just a very detailed response, but obviously all the kind of clear enthusiasm that you've got with the agenda, that really does sort of shine through. So we look forward to kind of future reports, particularly around the walking investment strategy locally, that will come forward to us. And obviously, if we can then remove the recommendations in paragraph 2 of the report, if that's agreed. Okay. Item 10 is public question time. We haven't received any public questions this time. Well, item 11, petitions and statements. We have received a petition signed by 89 people regarding the cancellation of the 135235 Bootle Bus Circular. Gordon, do you want to say a few words?
Yeah, I could just want to say a few words. We don't think that the customer practice for this transport, it's just not because I'm presenting it through, it's just if there is any big interest I have to declare. I think everyone's got to realise we don't say this, but just to ensure that I'm happy to take it, but I didn't think that was a problem.
No, that's fine. Record accordingly. I suppose, obviously, procedurally, we will give a full detailed response within 10 working days. Although, very briefly, I will just say, very politely, we were all very, very disappointed by the decision taken unilaterally by the bus company Avon to remove this and a number of other routes that they were providing on a commercial basis, which obviously puts us in a particularly difficult position, because one of the sort of real problems of deregulation means that when a bus company chooses to take on a bus service, then sort of they turn to the taxpayer to say you need to pick up your bill to subsidise it. And particularly in the teeth of very, very difficult austerity, we don't have huge amounts of money to step into the breach, even if that was the right thing to do. Obviously, this is an issue that has been raised not just with this petition. And I do know our offices are looking at some potential solution to try to improve what otherwise is a very, very difficult situation for residents in Bootle and other parts on the route accordingly, and other similar services that have been lost because of the decisions that Avon as a private bus company have taken unilaterally. So I suppose that kind of in sum is just where we're up to, but a full detailed response will go to the petitioners accordingly. Item 12 and last item is any other urgent business that's been approved. And Gordon, you've passed a motion to us that I think do you want to present it accordingly? Charlotte, do you want to We'll circulate it round so everyone's got a copy of that. I hope it's not contentious and it's something that we'll all strongly support, but I'll hand over to you just to have an explanation.
Thank you very much, Chair. I've not got a copy of that particular motion in front of me, but essentially, well, just to say that I have, but to be factually fair, we do have. And it's very simple, really. There's no other way of being notified. This committee wish to see any independent report commissioned to be put in the public domain and a copy of the said report for the Transport Committee. I think as we look at the chaotic things that we see going around, I think I'd love to understand what's been happening. We've particularly been disappointed with the responses that I've had in relation to the Southport and Manchester services, etc., etc. I don't feel there's any more that I'd add now to all the comments that have been made throughout the media and by the Metro Mayor. I think he covered every angle of that. So I think from a particular transport point of view, I'd like to show all the patterns that we need to see what the background is, and most particularly that the transport we can get back on and can have a discussion around it all that. And also, you may be inclined to invite someone from that place, top of the train operator, to come and address the committee. But if I could get support for this particular motion, I'd be very much obliged.
I think we can all support accordingly because won't comment in too much detail, but what should have been a significant improvement with a new timetable has ended up being an absolute nightmare for many people in this region and right beyond across the north. There are obviously a number of different factors that sit behind that, and it's right that an independent report is being done to identify all those detailed sort of elements. Once it can be properly understood and secondarily, hopefully it will never ever be repeated. But obviously we'll wait to sort of see and digest what's in that report. I'm certainly more than happy to support the motion as well, as I hope everyone else will do. And obviously you're suggesting about inviting a senior member of Northern Rail's management team to present to us at the next committee, because we regular operators come and present to us and giving us the opportunity to question them on their performance and their plans. We will try to pencil that in for July, because that's certainly very reasonable that in a public forum like this at a local level we can hold them to account on where it's gone badly wrong and how they're hopefully going to make sure it's never repeated again. So with that in mind, is everyone comfortable to support that motion? Chris, do you want to?
Just a quick question. Would the wording be Northern or Northern Rail?
It should be Northern Rail. It's a last-minute take.
Yeah, absolutely. But otherwise, is everyone happy to support that accordingly?
Yeah.
Is that agreed unanimously? Thanks very much. Appreciate that. Okay, and that brings us to the end of today's AGM. So thanks to everyone for your attendance. We look forward to seeing you at the next meeting in July.